Welcome to Dr. Spotfire. Can we move on to the next slide, please? So this is a session which is kind of driven by answers and questions. So learning is, for learning, it's important to ask questions. So that's why we kind of encourage you to ask questions. And we try to kind of find solutions here. So this is the team. I am Vishakha Muju. Then I have my colleague here, Divya Jyoti Raj Dev. She's associate data scientist. And we have our campaign manager, Alexis, who is running this campaign. So this is the crew who is helping you. We are all based out of Palo Alto. And let's go ahead and get started. Usually, like, the lines are mute by default. I'm not able to hear anyone so far. And feel free to post your questions on the chat panel. So let me go ahead and share my screen. So Alexis, can you give me the presenter right? Yeah, thank you. So let me go ahead and share my screen. So we have a question which was from the last session where we kind of discussed about how we are limiting data, using a data limiting by expression. So we have a question where we kind of saw data limiting with expression, but it did not work. So I have now the DXP file and I have that specific use case and the data limiting is not working. So let me take up that question first. So this is the DXP file which I have. Now the reason that is not working is because the way the scatter plot is created, so if I go to scatter plot properties, if I look at my x-axis, I have a column, this, on my y-axis, I have probit. So if I look at these settings, so let me show you the custom expression. So my x-axis is kind of based on probit. So this is the column which is it is based on, and it is using a calculation. And then if I go here on my so this is my y-axis. My x-axis is actually I'm using that as a kind of a property. So every time this property changes, so you can see every time this property changes, my values change. And that's how it is working. So it's my x which is changing. Now, what I try to do is I try to use a simple expression here. So let me go here and kind of go to properties. Because the way it is configured, it is different. So what I try to use is I try to use limit data by expression, but I use a different expression. Sorry. Let me copy paste that one. So I have this. So you can see because your x-axis is based on this probit 2, I have used this particular column. So I have used this particular column. And this escape is just to kind of give it a column name. So because the column names are always they are always enclosed in square brackets, that is why that escape is there. So it escape simply encloses it in the square brackets. That particular probit too, because that's the one which is kind of using x-axis, I just put the limit as less than 500. And you can see for this, there's no point less than 500. And if I go here, based on what I select, see here I'm seeing less than 500. And it's only up to 200. And based on whatever column I'm selecting, your limit may be kind of more than 500, but that value can be a property. So if I go to this data limiting by expression, this particular value, how you say what limit could be, this could be a numeric property. So you can kind of, instead of using this 500, I could create a property which could take that value. So let me show you quickly how to create that property. So if I insert a text area, I'm just creating a drop down here. So I'm editing my text area. I'm saying I need a property control, which is simply an input field, and I can call it as a new input. So whatever name I want to give it, I don't want it to be string. I want it to be an integer. So I want to give it a value. So right now, let me give default value as 600. I'm clicking OK. I have a new input property which has a default value of 600, and I have a box here which I can just I can use that property again, input field, and I have this new. So let me use new input, and it is integer, default value 600. Okay, I have given a space, so I don't need that space. Okay, I already have, so that means it's already here. So let me pick up that one. Okay, I just wanted to add new input here. So kind of a text so that we are clear, we can see that name. So this is 600 right now. And now I want to use that in here, expression. So what I can do is I have this data limited by expression. So I can go here, edit it. Instead of this 500, I can kind of search for that new input, and I can use that here. So you can see I have that new input property here, and I can click OK. I can click close. So now it is 600. So now if I say 6000, it will refresh, because in this case, let's say this one, you have 200 here, you have. So you can see now I'm seeing 2800, and if I reduce it to 600, it kind of gets reduced. So I'm controlling the limits with help of a property, whereas when I want to write an expression, I have to write exactly what is creating my x-axis. And in this case, it was that particular column. I did not use that calculation, but it was that column which was creating x-axis. Okay, so does that solve your requirement? I'm just looking at the chat panel or QA panel if we have any questions right now. So this was the question we received on email. Let me move on to the next set of questions. So these would be the questions we will be taking up today. So I have this list. Let me start with the first question. So we have this question here. We have a requirement to get max value in a cross table. Rank sum of value 1 as rank max. The calculation is not correct. Can anyone help me to get this question? So if I want to calculate kind of max of some particular calculation, so let me pick up my test data. So this is my test data, and let me just have a. Now, what I have done here is, so this is my test data, and you want to create a cross table. So let's say I have a cross table here. So you are looking at, say, gender, store location, female, male. Now, what I can do is I have sum of electronics. I can say I want a custom expression. I want electronics to be ranked. I can use a rank function. So I have a rank function. And then let's say I want electronics. Okay, so I can use column names, and I need to say, because it's for each row, so I need to specify that aggregation. So how do I want to rank? Now here, what I will do here is, so I have this will be for each row, so it's looking for the rank of each row. So what I can do is I can say, okay, I want max of that rank. So I am kind of using a max function within that rank and saying, okay, this is what it is. So for Boston, the max rank is 753. For Los Angeles, it's 752. For New York, it's 754. For Seattle, it's 751. Same thing goes to males. So, but what, how it is ranking is, it is ranking each row of my data. Now, if I don't want to rank each row of my data, I can always group by. So if you go to edit, say if you insert a calculated column or any custom expression and you want to look for rank function, you can see there is rank where it gives integer value. And then you can also kind of have a group by. For example, in this case, rank, you want to do it descending and you want to group by region. Each group should have one rank. You would be able to do that as well. But in a cross table, whenever you want to pick a max, so what, it may be your calculated column, you can say max of that. And I can have as many as, say, calculations. I can say comma, give me min of rank. In this case, this rank is not a calculated column, it's a custom expression, but I could create it as a calculated column also. So that was our kind of first question. So let me move on to next. I am also looking at chat panel if we have any questions. Could you please say how to group values within rows in cross table? So in a cross table, the grouping is already done by your x-axis and y. You're already grouping by store location, by gender. So if I take out the gender, I'm taking out the gender grouping. Now it is ranking overall, not by each gender. The moment I'm saying this is gender. So individual rank function is, so individual rank, because this is a rank function, it ranks individual columns. But if I want to kind of say, okay, give me rank by only region, so I'm using rank function for electronics. I'm not using descending. I am saying, okay, I want it by each gender. And then I close this one also. So electronics, each, oh, I kind of, okay, electronics, each gender, I can say ascending or descending. So let's say, let's use the full function. So I am ranking them by each gender. So now each gender would have a rank. And then let me still have the max. So you can see I have like, okay, there is 200 male, 208, and then there is this. Each gender within each location. So I'm having Boston, Los Angeles, New York, and Seattle, because my grouping is still there. So whenever you create a visualization, your plot properties group. But on the other hand, I can also use this rank function as a calculated column, where I can simply use this, and I don't need sum of electronics, I don't need max, I just say rank my data in a descending by each gender and rank them based on their electronics. And I can click OK. I can see this is my ranking. And then I can use this calculation in my visualization. So if I have a table visualization, I go to properties. I look at that column. Let me just have that electronics column. And in addition to electronics column, let me have this rank column. So now this ranking is by each gender. So I have a kind of a different ranking rather than just one single row. So it's but there's still other groupings there. Any other questions regarding this? Okay, the ranking function is also different. So you might see something getting ranked 1, 2, 3, 4. So if I insert a calculated column and let me look at the rank function. So for example, I have dense rank. It returns an integer value ranking of values in selected column. The first argument is column to be ranked. An optional argument is there. For highest value, it gives rank 1. So if you want to give rank 1 to lowest value, you have to use descending. Now, ties are given the same rank. So this is how the ties are kind of handled. And the highest ranking number equals the number of unique values in the column. So even if, like, I have one rank and then I suddenly have 208, means, okay, so there are different, in one ranking method, you would see I have, like, 200 values which have same. So all of them would get rank 1. But then the second value might get rank 2. Or it might get rank say 201. So I may have 1 and 201 or 1 or 2 depending on which ties method I use or which ranking function I am using. So different ranking functions, so here would be the description of that ranking function, whether you want to use min ties method, max or first or average, how you want to have that ties. So that would kind of decide what rank you will be getting. So when you say by gender or by within group, so they are ranked within that group. So if it is like gender, so within females, they would have ranking, and then there would be separate ranking within males. When we say New York, within New York, there would be ranking, and then we would have, and in this case, that New York, Seattle is a store location. Okay. In this example, what if you would like to have Boston, Los Angeles, and in one, both New York and Seattle? So in that case, I would have to have something which kind of groups Boston and Los Angeles as one, and New York and Seattle as two. So I can, what I can quickly do is, I can create a tag column. So I can view my tag panel. I can say, okay, in this tag column, I want to give a new location grouping. I can say new location. So I have my new location. I might switch this visualization to bar chart, makes it easier for me. And then what I would do is I can select store location here. And I can remove these. I don't need these. So I'm not worrying about what my y-axis is. So what I want is Boston, Los Angeles in one group. I would create in this, I would create new tags. I would call Boston, Los Angeles. So that would be one group. I would create another tag and call it New York, Seattle. So I'm just giving them name. Boston, Los Angeles, I will mark. I will click here. Right click, attach tag to marked rows. New York, Seattle, I will mark. So this is a very quick way of getting a new column from your existing column. Right click, attach tag to marked rows. So I just accidentally attached this tag to rows without a tag. So I kind of picked Los Angeles also, which is in a different group. So I can say attach this tag to rows without a tag. So now if I use that particular column, which is my new column, new location, you can see this is how it is. My Boston and Los Angeles are there because my color by shows me both are there, part of this location. Now this is the one I can use for my ranking, so I can group them. Oh, these two are together and then these two are together, because now I have a column new location which I can use for my grouping.
Vishakha, could you also show the custom sorting feature that we have, the custom ordering feature for columns?
Yes. So what we can do is if we go to edit column properties, we can, so for example, I have store location. I need the sort order seats, alphabetic sort order. We always see Boston first, then we see Los Angeles, New York. I can configure it for a custom sort order. Okay, which one needs to come first? Maybe Seattle should move up. So every time I create a visualization, I would see Seattle kind of being the first. So if I look at store location, so I have store location, so I can pick up store location. Now you can see Seattle comes up first. So that is like custom sort order. So you can specify which location would be the first and then followed by next. Okay, so there are new calculated columns. Where are they added? They are added to your table. So whatever your data table is, whatever your data set is, if I go to edit column properties, I pick up my table. I could have multiple tables here. I see all my imported, so whatever I have kind of got from external location, they are called imported columns. They could be from a database, they could be coming from an Excel, from a CSV, but what I have here is I have those here. So whatever calculation, so I created this input row index, I created some other calculation, ranking, right now we created a tag column, they are all here. So I can always go here and modify them. So ranking I want to modify, I can modify them. I have these tags. I cannot modify them from here, but I can modify them from directly from the tag panel. I can make something untagged or change it. They are all here. And every time you refresh your data, so if I go to edit data table properties, source information, you can see every time I refresh my data, I don't have to do that calculation again. It's automatically calculated. So for example, this is the data which is coming from. The moment I refresh it, this calculation will be again calculated. This will be again done, and this would be again done. The only thing with tags is the tags would be saved only if you have a primary key defined. So if there is no primary key, the Spotfire has no way to know, because how it says that this Boston and Los Angeles belong to this group is if you have a primary key defined. So what we do is if we go to data table properties, we can specify that key column. So we call that a key column, which could be a customer ID. So if, or it could be a location, which could be combination of things. So whatever way you define your key column, when data refreshes, that's how your calculations will be automatically updated. And you can use these calculated columns for further calculation. And I can kind of say insert calculated column. I can use any of these calculations, whatever I created, ranking, further in calculations. So let me pick up now another question. So unable to find tools register data function in Spotfire. So like you see, I have here tools register data function, and then you don't see that register data function in your case. So it is possible, and it depends on your the way your Spotfire is set up. So let me quickly kind of log in. So let me pick up. So I'm not connected to server, so I just want to connect to server. So I am just connecting to server. So I was working offline, but now I'm connected to server. You can see there is online here option. Now if I go to tools, so I want to see, because I'm an administrator here, this is what your administrator does. He provides you part of groups and licenses. That's how, and there are preferences. So for example, you are part of any everyone group, and then this is where you have these preferences. He can add your preferences, and he can even kind of have what kind of permissions you would have. So that would be another thing. He can edit those members. He can edit the permissions. So he has these licenses here, which he can edit. Now these licenses, by default, they are defined as like top level. This would be a consumer. This would be enterprise player. But I could kind of uncheck even this level. So I don't want you to register data functions. And usually they don't want anything to do with the scripting. I don't want you to do that. I can uncheck that. Even in the extensions, I can uncheck this part, author scripts. So I can kind of have, okay, author script is not enabled for this user, so he won't be able to do any scripting. So similarly, for everything there is kind of, for administrator also, there are these licenses or permissions which can be set for a group, which can be enabled or disabled. So it will be your Spotfire administrator who would be able to give you that permission, where that particular piece, which is like registered data functions, would be enabled. So then I have another one is show different column name in a tooltip. So let me go back to test data. So you want to see a different column name in a tooltip. So tooltip is something when I hover on any of these bars, I see store location, some electronics. I see this as a kind of tooltip. So if I go to properties, this is the tooltip. So by default, it shows me whatever is my X, Y, color by. I can uncheck that. I can add anything as a tooltip. So for example, I'm using electronics in store location. I can use any other column. I can use any other calculation. So I can say I want furniture. I want total furniture and show me as a text. Or I can, if I have an image from URL, I can set up that as well. So let me show it as a text. Include value name in tooltip, or I can say, okay, no. I can click OK. I can say visualize, use value names and values, or use visualization properties. I can kind of change the naming, how they display. Now when I hover, I see some furniture. I see that as a tooltip. Now, let's say I don't want to call it some furniture. So I can even, it's a custom expression. So I can right click and say custom expression. I can give it a name as custom tooltip. Okay. So I can call it something else. It could be a complete calculation, and it has nothing to do with what is your X or Y. It could be using different columns. So that would be way to have, and it's not only in bar chart, in every visualization. So for example, you are in a scatter plot, you would see this kind of custom expression, this property called tooltip. So, and but it works only when you hover. By default, it is these values, but you can always add your own tooltips. So let me see, we have another question. Will the session be recorded so I can reference it later? Yes, the session is recorded, and you will have access to this recording. It's a public recording. It will be available. Alexis can kind of point you to the page where previous recordings are also available. Okay, so let me move on to the next question. Is it possible to show current month filters by default with option to select other months from a drop-down list in Spotfire? So what I did in this case is I used this test data. So this is what I was kind of working. So you can see I have this most recent date. And I created a calculation. So let me show you the calculation which I created. So I have this calculation. Now in this calculation, what I have done is, because I have multiple years, so if I pick just month, it will pick month from like all the years. My current month, it has to match year as well as month. So I'm saying if month is month, there's a function called date time now, which just returns me today's date and time. And if that and year both match, call that month as current. For everything else, I don't want to call them current. I want to call them simply concatenate month and year. And that's what is this here. So I have 10/7/2016. It's called current because it's current month. It has 10 as matching for October and 2016. Rest everything is 2012 data. Now what I had really old data. So what I did here was I just changed one of the dates. Now let me show you, and that works for calculated columns also. They will automatically be refreshed. Let me show you if I change something else, like here 10/2016. So I think this one is that because I'm looking at most recent purchases. I'm not looking at date joined, so I'm changing this. And let me save this. And if I open this file, it will automatically refresh it. I will reload the data. You can see now I have two dates which are current. Now what I can do is I can insert a text area. I can use this calculation as a filter. So I can say, okay, insert a filter. And don't use anything column, use this calculation. And I can have that as a filter. So you can see I have all the 14 values and one of them is current. If I pick up current, it shows me only current. If I pick up April 2012, it shows me only those that month. So I have a filter. Now if I change this filter type here, I say, okay, this filter type, I don't want drop down list. I want to change the filter type to checkbox. this gives me a checkbox. So based on what my filter type is here, I can have the same filter type in my text area and use it for my filtering purposes. Okay, so we already have on the chat panel the link for the recording, so which is this link which Alexis has provided us. Thank you. Let me move on to our next question. So I want to have a button which will perform filter out marked rows, reset marking, reset zoom slider, these three actions in a single click. So it will filter out the marked rows, it will reset markings, and it will kind of reset zoom slider in a single click. Now, let me show you how to do that. So what we have is we have bookmarks, we have action control. Now, what I can do is, so if I go to edit text area, I can insert an action control. Now, what I want is reset all marked rows or unmark marked rows. This is one. I want to, say, filter out something, or I want to do something next. So this is unmark marked rows, and I want to reset all filters. Followed by that, I can reset all filters. So the way this will be applied, it will be applied in top-bottom order. And for zoom sliders, I might create a bookmark and add that bookmark here. So all these three actions, so if I go here and I say, okay, show me filters or hide the filters after this. So unmark marked rows, reset all filters, and hide. And this is like three actions. And I have this one button which kind of gives me those three actions. So I have this three actions button. So you can see I have my filter panel here. Let me mark something. Let me filter out something. The moment I click on these three actions, unmark, filter out, and if the filter panel was not there, it would kind of show. It's not toggle. It just shows that filter panel. So you can see now it shows that filter panel. So I'm able to do three actions. Now these actions can be defined in your text area. These actions could be bookmarks, these actions could be any of these scripts, but this allows you to combine those actions into one step, and they're always applied in top-bottom order. So first, the next, next, and next. It could be combining these out-of-box functions, it could be combining the bookmarks, it would be navigating to something else, it would be kind of a data function also. So all these can be combined together in one step. So Vishaka, let me, yes.
This is David. I just wonder, can you also stack scripts in the same way?
Yes, same you can interface? Always, yes. You can always, in the same interface, if you kind of go here, you can always add the scripts, but that would be just, so it's more for the action controls. For that, if your scripts are attached to some property, then you would be able to kind of combine them. So usually when we want to stack scripts, we attach our scripts to properties. So what we do is anytime that property value changes, we can have one script trigger next script, and that trigger the next script. So that's not like straightforward, but what we do is we kind of add those scripts here, and we attach them to a property, and we change that property in order to make the second script trigger. But this is like for out of box. So that would be there. Then I have next question is refreshing predictive columns in Spotfire analysis. Does anyone know what is the reason that predicted columns are not refreshed automatically? So what we have here is let me pick up this one here. So when we insert, any kind of, we do regression modeling. So we do out-of-box regression modeling, and I pick up a response column, let's say variable one. I pick up these six columns, I add them, and I say, okay, and I refresh my data. Now, in this case, if it is linked to the source and I try to refresh my data, I would, the model would get refreshed. So I don't think in this case it is linked to the data. Let me pick up this test data. Let me insert a regression modeling because this one is linked to the source and I will be able to show you. So let me predict electronics based on furniture garden. Okay, so I'm just creating a model. Now what I can do is I can make changes to my data and say file, reload data. Now when I reload this data, it didn't automatically refresh. What happens is I see this red icon. I would have to click on it in order to kind of refresh it. So what we can do is if we want that functionality, so when we are editing this model, I would say you can go to Ideas portal and you can kind of ask for that we want here an option where it would refresh that model automatically. Right now, the capability is you can refresh your model only when you kind of click here. But there is another way around this is because if I have created a data function, so for example, in this case, I have a data function which is using the same out-of-box script. It is fitting the model, it is calculating variable 5 based on variable 1 and variable 2. I am having inputs as variable 1, 2, and 5. I am having output as an output table. But what I have in this case is I can specify, do I need to refresh this function automatically? So every time there is a change in the data, if I check this, it will refresh automatically. And I can even say why I need to run this function. Do I need to run it locally or do I need to run this function on server? So this, when you create your own data functions, you already have that capability. But when you use out-of-box functions, right now, this is kind of by default unchecked. That is why whenever you would be kind of reloading your data, it would be kind of so whenever you will reload your data, it kind of goes, it reloads the data, it shows you that there is some problem with your data function, and this red icon tells you to refit. And the moment you click on that, it kind of refits. But definitely this could be something which could be added. I can post it on the Ideas portal, but you can always kind of go to Ideas portal and kind of have this as an add-on. So, Alexis, if you can provide everybody the link to the Ideas portal, that would be helpful. Now, we have today our guest speaker. So, let me introduce our guest speaker. So, we have today David Katz with us, who has 30-plus years of experience, and it's a really great thing to be working with him, who has worked with companies like Williams-Sonoma, popularly like Pottery Barn would be known as one of their subsidiaries. He holds a master's degree in mathematics from UC Berkeley. He was director of database development at Williams-Sonoma and as one of the founders of Abaca's direct marketing company, which is part of DoubleClick, and now it is part of Google. And since joining Spotfire in 2011, he has been active in planning the direction of several TIBCO products in analytics area as well as wide variety of client projects, including Hadoop and big data projects. He recently posted A/B test data function for Spotfire, and that's what he would be discussing. It is available on Exchange. It is available to download, and it is something which anybody can use, replace their data, and would be able to use this data function. So he will be providing insights to this data function, which is already available on Exchange. And if you download it, if you use it, definitely provide us review, provide us some comments, what you want to add on to it, the ways you want to improve it, and if you really like it, do review this data function. So let me pass on the ball to David. Can you make him the presenter, Alexis?
Okay, and I will share my screen. Can everyone hear me all right?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. All right. So, let's just go through these slides fairly quickly, and then I'll do a demo. So, A/B testing is a familiar concept for those of us who've done marketing analytics of any kind. I had the opportunity to work with a mail order company years ago that was really in the forefront of doing A/B testing. They did dozens of tests per year on their mail order design. They would test pricing, they would test copy, they would test graphics, and even to the point of testing scent versus no scent. That was the when they were selling lilac plants. So it's a very interesting area, and it's tremendously useful. So this is, what we're going to talk about. Our time is limited, so I'm just going to kind of go through these concepts pretty quickly. But sometimes, there's different terminology. You might call it split run or a bucket test. And the idea is very simple. You want to compare a test versus a control. So you have some kind of new new presentation, new advertising program or promotion, change in pricing, and you want to see, well, what effect has this had? Well, it's not too hard to just do a summary and compare the before and after, but the real challenging part is, is that a meaningful difference? Can we expect to repeat this difference when we do it again? Other things being equal, you don't expect to get, in this case, you don't expect to get 46 and 54 again, but will always be beating A, or generally in most cases be beating A. So that's the challenge, is to really not just summarize the data, but to get an idea of what is the variability that's due to chance, and what is the variability that what is the signal behind that variability that you can kind of count on in making your plans for next time around. So this is, as we've moved to more and more online approaches, it's still very useful in traditional retail approaches. If you have coupons, if you have advertising, you want to be data driven, and you want to look at the difference between two treatments or two approaches. And some companies have gotten tremendous boosts by using that methodology repeatedly. It's a very powerful methodology. Here's an example that Vishaka found, just making a change to the visualization, or here's one where we've changed the menu and it seems to be a change for the worse. So it's very important, if you're trying to deal in the real world, you might have an opinion of which is better, but it might not match the opinion of your users. So what I want to do is talk about the tools that we've presented. We have four use cases, we have four different data functions, and then we've got a demonstration DXP where we show how those data functions might be used. And let me switch over to one of these. Let's get the one I want. So what I'm going to do is start with this one. It's a case. This is simulated data for a retail chain of coffee sellers. They're in different regions. And you can select a region, and you see there's a difference in this summary of sales by month, in that when you get to Oakland, you see that there's a coloration that indicates that something different has happened here. And this was a promotion that was run just in Oakland, just in these months. And what we're trying to do, again, we're trying to get a comparison that will tell us how much of an increase in sales is random and how much seems to be related to the signal. So what I'm going to do is mark a couple of date ranges so that these are comparable. So this date range has the time period during which the test was going on, and this one is the previous year. By using the previous year, you get some help in adjusting for seasonality. So we see, just looking at this, there does seem to be seasonality. Now, trend is another matter. We'll address that in a couple of minutes. But ignoring trend, we'd like to compare and see whether this promotion has altered our sales. So we've got a data function attached to this button, and what it does is go through and it actually does a simulation based on a couple of assumptions. And the assumption is that the number of orders is a Poisson kind of process, which just means that it's the distribution that you normally see for counts. So each month you have a different count of orders, and then within those counts there's different dollar amounts. And we just use what's called an empirical distribution, saying that we expect in the future the same kind of distribution. So what we have in this center is the results of this simulation to say, well, what is the ratio of the test results and the control results? Well, because we're simulating it, there's a range of outcomes. But that's exactly what we want. We want that range of action of outcomes to give us an idea of the variance or the standard deviation that we're looking at here. And so we, you know, by doing that, we can get this breakdown. These are some categories, and here's the total. And here's the overall test versus control and difference, and then the observed ratio between them. And then we get the confidence interval. So by default, we have a 95% confidence interval, and we see that there is some chance that it's below one, but in general, it seems to be quite a bit above one. So there's some evidence of an improvement. It's not completely definitive, but it's helpful. You know, sometimes you see that the lower end is above one, so you can pretty much count on in 95% of the cases that you know, you'd get some improvement, and then you have an average improvement and an upper estimate of the improvement. So let me just do a quick demonstration of how you would use that. Suppose you downloaded this data function and you wanted to put it into your own DXP. So this is a version of the DXP. It has the same data, but it doesn't have the version 4 data functions. So in order to add it, it's pretty simple. You just say you want to insert a data function. And if it was if you had it in your internal library, this would be an option. But in the case where you do the download, you would just obtain the file. You probably have to unzip it, and then you would be able to browse, and then you can go to the right directory, which is the A/B test directory. And here's AB4. Here's my latest version of AB4, and I just select that, and I get this dialog. So most of the work has already been done for me. The script is there, the definitions of the input and output to the script. But now all that remains is for me as a user to connect that up to the data that you have in your DXP. So here it looks like the same DXP we used before, but the intent is that you're working on some project, you've done some summarization, you have a bunch of choices. Now you're going to use this pre-built data function. So the target, what we're looking for is to use the input here. It's called the user table, and you want to select the column that's your target, which in this case is the sales. You also have these helpful descriptions. You know, the first time you do this, it won't be obvious. What do I mean by the target? Well, it's the sales column or other numeric target of the comparison that you're trying to make. So that selection, you can select the sales and add it, and then you see that it appears here. And the other thing you want to do is really only use the marked rows so that you're controlling the time period that you're working with. And of course, in your case, there might be other choices that you'd make here. Maybe the data doesn't have to be limited by marking. But if it is, you have this ability to do it. You also have to do the ability to limit it by filtering. So you have a lot of flexibility. So then the category is actually optional. That it was the cold brew versus novelty versus standard. I'm just to show the flexibility, I'm going to say, well, we just want the total. We're not going to deal with that. But we do need this control column. It's the column to identify best versus control. The data function recognizes 1 and 0. It also recognizes the string test and the string control. So you do the same thing. You say, I'm working with the input that I want. And in this input, the identifier is the promotion table, which is 0, 1. And I want to have it be comparable in terms of this. So then all that's left to be done is to say, well, what do I do with the output? Well, really, I only care about the summary table. Maybe there's an error message or a status message that's this field over here that said no errors. And the simulation ratio, you could leave it at none if you weren't going to have this visualization, but you could also say I have a data table which here is set up to be the simulation ratio. So now when I complete this, it doesn't just save it, it just goes ahead and tries to execute it. That's the behavior. We see it on the bottom that it's working. And because there's only one category, we just get one distribution of, and again, this is the distribution of the ratio from all these simulations we did. So the median is, you know, a little less, is like 1.1 or 1.09, and here it is, it's actually 1.04. Like I didn't hook it up properly to this. So let's just fix that again. Let's go back. See, if you need to, you can go back and edit those parameters and make sure you've got the output of the summary table going where you want it to go. So, you know, let's finish this by adding in the category table. From the user table, and it's the product class that we want to look at and the marked rows. So now we should get something. Looks like that. So now we're back to where we started. We have the categories, the total column, and the confidence interval. With the lower end and the upper end of the confidence interval. So not to go on too long, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the fact that we have these four different scenarios. And the reason for having four different ones is that statistically you'd handle these very differently. Sometimes, you know, if you send out an email, you know how many emails you sent out, so you know the reach of what you're trying to analyze. However, in the case that I was looking at, we had newspaper advertising. We didn't know exactly what the reach was, so we have to make a somewhat different assumption statistically. Likewise, if we're counting responses, we take one approach, or if we have a continuous outcome like a sales amount, we take another account. So you've got four different levels that enable you to, you know, choose the right function for the use case that you're looking at. So I'll open it up to questions. If anyone has any questions about what I presented or how to use this, let me know. Will that just show up in the chat? Is that how it works?
Thank you. Thank you, David. Can you, Alexis, can you give me the presenter? Thank you. So, any questions, feel free to post on the chat. We had a question about SAP HANA. So, first of all, what is SAP HANA? So, I kind of pasted a Wikipedia link. Now, how the SAP HANA is related to us, it is because you can add your, you can open, add your data table from multiple data sources, and there are like multiple data sources which are available, and SAP HANA is one of the data sources. So this is how Spotfire can connect to even Amazon Redshift, and there are like other data sources, the ones which are grayed out. I don't have those enabled right now. So these are the data sources which Spotfire can connect. Now we have a question which we are going to definitely include in our next Spotfire session is, Spotfire can connect to data sources as import data tables. So if I check this, if I have a data source here and I check it, yeah, that would be an import data table. So let me just pick up something from file and say, let's say this is the data table. If I say import data table, it becomes in memory. If I say keep data table external, that's where it stays in the data source, that's in database. And then we also have a way to connect to data sources using Spotfire server. So when I am kind of connected to, if I am on, online, so in one of these I was connecting online, so this is online. If I open from, say, library, this is my Spotfire server, and on the server I could have connectivity to different data sources. SAP HANA could be connected there. So what are the advantages of using information link versus in memory? So it will take some time to explain. I will have to use more examples to kind of explain what are the things which kind of get changed, what you get in information links, and what mostly it's performance which you try to enhance when it comes to keeping data table external. That's the major thing which you kind of try to work on, but we will cover this in details in our next Spotfire session. So that will be all for today. Do we have any other questions? So we have one more question that is, is it possible to link summary and detailed report using cross table the way we do it using graphical table? So if you're saying if you can click on a graphical table and then open up another, so graphical table has action controls. So right now we don't have any other visualization which can work with action controls, but we do have this already submitted on Ideas portal, where you could kind of we could add that capability to other visualizations as well. But you can always
there
use a text
nice
area.
Workaround. Vishaka, can I interject something?
Yes.
The workaround that I've used for that is to convert the cross table into a regular table by exporting it and then re-importing it. So if you go to, you know, if you view it and you look at the export menu, you can export it from the visualization, and you actually create a text version of the table that can then be re-imported, and then you've got a normal table that you can do a drop down on. So you lose the dynamic quality of the cross table, but sometimes that fills the bill.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, David. So that will be all for today. So write us on drspotfire@theratetipco.com. and feel free to join our next Dr. Spotfire session. Thank you. Have a good day.